So let's go through a little bit of fun thing, because people always love picking on things. So let's go pick on testing for a bit. Let's go look at some pitfalls of testing. So these are three that I came up with that are pretty high on the list. For sure, there's lots of other ones. But let's take a look at the first one. The first one is human bias. So we're always influenced out of all of our decisions, kind of like I never lie type of thing. Like people who say that they're not biased is unfortunate, because it's just not true, right? So we all favor paths and outcomes. I'm not telling you not to be biased. What I'm saying is be aware of your biases, okay? So, you know, we have biases maybe to simplistic data, or, you know, as a tester, as a coder, we might, you know, look at the code a certain way and we might have some of that. You know, what I'm saying as a good tester, you should be aware of those and do your best to try to think against your biases, because you're sort of being paid or employed or used because of your agnosticism or the objectiveness and stuff like that, right? So yes, you should hold yourself to a higher standard than other people, but your bias, you should understand, affects your testing. So if I know that, like, you know, if I don't want to gain weight, I'm not going to probably eat at McDonald's every day kind of thing, right? This is kind of one of those housekeeping things, right? Like, let's look at our human biases. Keep thinking about things, you know. Am I always tending towards exception data? You know, and I only test inputs and I don't necessarily test outputs. Am I always the type of guy who, you know, doesn't read the manual and looks at and tests the application? It might be really good, but there might be some errors in the manual, or, you know, like, there's type of things. So let's look at your biases, right? That help you. Another one, so this is kind of like an example I gave you. I don't know if they're just sort of soccer fans, but the idea is they ran a study a couple years ago and they said tall football players are more likely to be accused by fouls. The idea is, like, I think the referee always picks the little big guy picking on David and Goliath type of thing. So that's an example. And so this study was quite interesting if you want to take a look at it. But, you know, like, we always have kind of, sometimes, I don't want to use laziest, but the idea is, like, you know, we use simplistic data. You know, enter 8 characters, 1, 1, 1, 1. Use the same one over and over again. Even if you're lazy, if you know your bias, you can use 2, 2, 2 or QQQ or something like that, right? So we're not trying to make you not, okay, I don't want you to be lazy, okay, that's not the point. But the idea is your bias actually affects that. It's not just the laziness, it's actually the bias that's on top of that. And, you know, I'm not trying alternate preconditions, right? So let's look at the other one. This is groupthink. I guess I probably should use maybe lemmings or something, but there's penguins here, okay? The idea is that we're often driven by social desirability, right? Guys on your team are gonna be hammering on you. They say, we gotta ship today, or if we don't get to the customer, they're not gonna want it anymore. And you know, but at the end of the day, we wanna ship good software, right? The goal is having better software through testing, right? So, you know, history buffs, you know, bit pigs here. The idea is that groupthink is it affects us, right? So like the bias thing, there's also team kind of a bias and a group type of thing. And as testers, sometimes we have to stand up, and as quality assurance people, we have to kind of stand up for ourselves and give that little bit of conflict to the team. Say, people want it to be verified and quick and to ship. Well, that's not really possible. You know, everyone's tired. It's not really a bug. Well, you have to push back and say, is that really a reason? Am I going to be, you know, am I giving in because of that social desirability, or am I giving in because I agree with that point? Right? So there's quite a bit of this, right? People complain, not a bug. The idea is here, this one's supposed to isolate one that's not really a science part, but the idea is, like, there is a lot of social skill within how to get your bugs fixed too, right? Okay, so inference and assumptions, right? So humans can be fooled by patterns. Indicators, not really results. Test for results. The idea is, what happens is, you guys all know the idea of a false positive, right? So you go to the doctor, sometimes they give you a test, right? Say, like, a litmus paper turns different colors or something like that. And then from that test, they give you a result. They say, you know, yes, it's positive or it's negative, right? Most of the time, we imply that the result of the test is the result of the condition. But the idea is there's false negatives and false positives, right? What if something's wrong with the test in itself? So as testers, we have an inference and assumptions. So this slide here is to kind of remind you that really you're only testing your test. Right? So always kind of go back to your assumptions, because we've seen this before where people go, okay, hey, this piece of software, it's going to go out, that bug doesn't exist, right? And we run the test and sometimes it isn't. But the problem is actually underlying, but that's because either the test didn't catch it, wasn't designed properly, or the assumption was wrong. Like in cases like, for example, software's never slow. Well, have you run it on this particular device on this particular ROM? No, I ran it on this other one. Well, you made an assumption that that would be the same on another platform, right? So this is the one validation, you know, reproducibility, stuff like that. But I wanted to get you kind of out there. It's like, we're kind of sometimes fooled by inference and assumptions, right? You know, like, you hear things like, last time the screen didn't didn't blink, it worked fine. And then people say the screen didn't blink and they don't test the rest of it because they had a preconceived notion. They knew that the last time it did something, it was gonna go down that path. Well, no, as a tester, you need to follow up and go through with it. Things like, it only blinks when the value is blank. Well, sure, you stop there, but you know, a good tester will go back and say, well, what other values is it? It's always just blank. Like, test around there, figure out the other thing. There's no errors in the log, everything should be fine. This is another case of like where the test is wrong. Well, maybe the problem is it crashed before it even got to the log file, something like that, right? Just because there's no log of the error doesn't mean it didn't exist. Last time the bugs were caught with less tests. Well, sure, that's great, but that's just true. It's a little comic here about Pavlov's dog, but okay. So we're almost through this one little section here, so bear a little bit. So we're gonna come up with some testing humor. So break the ice a little bit here before we take a little pause. This is from Will and Perry. He has a great book here, and one of the ones is he has a sign. He has this idea. I got the sign from somebody else, but the idea is a good tester. He's saying testing people are just different. Okay, they're different. Different sometimes good, sometimes bad, but the idea is testers are different. So if you want to be a good tester, what he says is a good tester looks both ways before crossing a one-way street, right? The idea is like, it's almost like you're in the expectation that something's gonna go wrong. Testers are different people, they are. So this is another one. How can you go with software slide without Dilbert, right? So the idea is here it says, our goal here is to write bug-free software. I'll pay $10 bonus for every bug you find and fix. And these guys are going, Yahoo, yeah, we're rich, yes. I hope this drives the right behavior. I'm gonna write me a new minivan now. Right. See, I got this other one from a site that's documented within the notes here, but this guy came up with some bumper stickers of testers. And the first one is, my other car is a bug. If your software works, thank a tester. I don't make software, I make software better. Improving the world one bug at a time. Software testers don't break software, it's broken when we get it. Pretempto ergo sum, I test therefore I am, and testing, we make IT work. I believe I have one more. So this guy had a whole list of these type of things, and he says, you know, because these are definitions of the worldview of testers. Because the glass, you know, to an optimist, the glass is half full. To a pessimist, the glass is half empty. The good tester says, the glass is twice as big as it needs to be.